city walls are closing in, and I wish I could hold your hand in a cabana down in Mexico. These day-to-days are losing flavor. I ain't got the cash to take you. Better find another way to go. Yeah, you say, when we taking a vacation, I can't take much more. So I say, just be patient. We're still saving, but what we waiting for? Let's act like Tijuana, right here in California. It's all the same when I got you. Just let that margarita make you my senorita. Maybe we'll cross a line or two. I know we're not south of the border, but don't this kinda make you wonder? Are we in Tijuana? Are we in Tijuana? Oh, honey, it's time to mix it up. Let's put vacation in a cup, and we don't even have to leave the house. Yeah. Let's you and I go cut a line and act like we're on summertime and move Mariachi around the couch.
There you go.
Yeah, we're tequila taking, trouble making. Darling, that's a heavy pour. I'm just saying, while we're waiting, what we're waiting for? Let's act like Tijuana, right here in California. It's all the same when I got you. These day-to-days are losing flavor. I ain't got the cash to take you. Better find another way to go. Yeah, you say, when we taking a vacation, I can't take much more. So I say, just be patient. We're still saving, but what we waiting for? Let's act like Tijuana, right here in California. It's all the same when I got you. Just let that margarita make you my senorita. Maybe we'll cross a line or two. I know we're not south of the border, but don't this kinda make you wonder? Are we in Tijuana? Vacation in a cup, and we don't even have to leave the house. Let's you and I go cut a line and act like we're on summertime and move the mariachi around the couch.
There you go.
Yeah, we're tequila taking, trouble making. Darling, that's a heavy pour. I'm just walls are closing in, and I wish I could hold your hand in a cabana down in Mexico. These day-to-days are losing flavor. I ain't got the cash to take you. Better find another way to go. Yeah, you say, when we taking a vacation, I can't take much more. So I say, just be patient. We're still saving, but what we waiting for? Let's act like Tijuana, right here in California. It's all the same when I got you. Just let that margarita make you my senorita. Maybe we'll
show with me, your host, Kayla Malari. Now, this is episode four. Wow, went through a whole month of episodes. That's a lot. If you haven't caught up, we have episodes 3, 2, 2.5, and 1 on our YouTube channel, and I've been going over the history of the Corps from the beginning. Now, if this is your first time here, Ayubon, welcome. I am Kayla Malari. I am the current CEO of the Corps Dance Crew. And if you didn't know, I did play Todoroki in our Boku no Hero set. And as you saw, I played Sakura and ATM and Sailor Jupiter and a bunch of other people. Oh yeah, I also recently changed my hair because my soulmate, Sonali, my co-founder of Corps Dance Crew, has been making me a lot of galaxy paintings. If you know me, I love space, everything, astronomy, and astrology. And so I ended up doing a galaxy kind of hair. It's like blue and purple, there's things going on. But yes, so we are on episode 4 of the history of the Corps, a brief and annotated version. Now, it's not everything to do with the Corps, but it's as much as I can remember and get through. And it is all accurate because I would know. Now, we left off last week with, what did we leave off with? Oh, I just got my knee surgery. So I had my knee surgery. We won maxed out with our burlesque set. And we had just started our special ops squad for Corps. So Corps at this time is split up into 3 different crews. We have special ops, which is the smaller crews that can do a lot more of the performances on smaller stages. We have Alpha crew, which is like the really, really tiny one that's prepping for HHI, Hip Hop International in the summer. Then we have Beta crew, which is a little bit bigger. And then we have Omega, which is the entire Corps dance crew. Now, we just finished with the year. This is also the 106th squadron. So we go by the years based off of Attack on Titan. So our first year was the 104th squadron because that was Eren Jaeger's squadron. And then we went from there. So we are now on the 106th and we are starting the year 2016. Now, I don't know about you, but 2016 was a tumultuous year for a lot of people. And it was for Corps as well. This was the year where we are slowly starting to evolve into something. We've just changed our name. And as we will see starting in January of 2016 and going on, there's going to be a change in the way Corps just kind of is. It's not a bad change. Change isn't bad. Okay, it's not change. It's an evolution. There's an evolution of what Corps is. So what happened? Well, in January of 2016, Corps got to be at ALA, Anime Los Angeles, for the very first time. We had never done this convention before, and we had only started this year, well, that year, to delve into other conventions. So we were going to be at ALA for the first time, and their theme, the Allison Meyer told me and Sonali, was idols. So they have a theme for their whole convention, and the theme was idols. So she said, can you guys do opening ceremonies, a performance for opening ceremonies, and then also you're going to do a performance for the Masquerade halftime. And if the theme is idols, and me and Sonali got to be judges for their very first idol contest, where it was a singing contest to find ALA's top idol, we were like, let's make our own idol group. Like our own version of what idols would be. So it's a mixture of anime idols and like real life idols. Oh, Q Bakugo. Thanks, babe. Do you want to say hi? Come here.
I have to pee.
Okay, we'll just... Oh, great. Bakugo had to pee. Rossin just brought me coffee. He just got home from work. Isn't that sweet? He brought me coffee because he knows I need it. I don't need it. We're doing our version of idols. So we have a special operations squad that's doing an idol thing. So we did a cover of Love Live for it, and then we added some like actual J-pop groups to it. And then we also added like just our own choreo. But as we're doing it, this is Beta Squad now, not Alpha Squad. Alpha Squad was Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Now we've moved on to the larger special operations squad. And it's all guys and girls, and we didn't really have a name. We were just calling ourselves SO. We were calling each group SOA, SOA, not SEO, not like Sword Art Online, but SOA for Alpha. But we couldn't really call Beta Squad SOB because that's not good. it's not good. So we were like, what are we going to name ourselves? My sister, in her infinite dad way, was like, oh my gosh, we should call ourselves Soy Socks. Now we were like, why Soy Socks? She was like, well, one, we're majority Asian, so let's just, it's like soy sauce, but S-O-Y-S-O-X, special ops Y for Y chromosomes, and special ops X for X chromosomes, because we're guys and girls. And it was the nerdiest way to come up with an idol name. But all of us were like, oh my gosh, that is hilarious. So from then on, anytime we've ever done anything idol related or a cover of K-pop dances or anything, we've always called ourselves Soy Socks. S-O-Y-S-O-X. Soy Socks. So that's why we say Soy Socks a lot. Soy Socks was so much fun. We did an opening number and we did a Masquerade halftime number, and then we also did a freestyle at ALA. Now this was going to mark, this was when ALA was at the end of January, it wasn't at the beginning, it was at the end. So I had my surgery at the beginning of December, went all through December, and then most of January, and I was like, we needed, but there was a spot for one more girl on the stage. And I talked with Sonali about it. I talked with my sister and our board at the time. And I was like, you know what? I think this is going to mark my return to the stage. I had been going to physical therapy. If you've ever had an injury, take physical therapy seriously. There's no fix-all for it. It takes hard, freaking work to come back from an injury if you want to do it smart and never get an injury again. Now, I was supposed to be out for 3 months. At the least, it was supposed to take 6 months. 6 months for me to recover from knee surgery. At the least, 3 months. It has been 6 weeks, and then I went back to the stage. But here's the thing. If you fast forward, I've never had a problem with this knee since. I've always taken care of it. They just, for your information, in order to recreate my ACL, they had to take a piece. There's two options. There was an option where you can take cadaver tissue, fashion an ACL, and put it in my knee. But there's issues with that because there's the possibility that your body will reject the cadaver tissue. And the doctor told me that, and I said, I already have crazy nightmares, and like, I'm pretty sure there's a demon living in my head. I'm not gonna have cadaver tissue in my knee and then like the ghost of, you know, two-step Bob comes haunting me because I have part of his tissue in my knee. So I was like, no cadaver tissue. She's like, okay, so then we're going to take some of your other tissue. We're going to take it from your hamstring in the same leg, like melon baller, scoop it out, and then create an ACL that way. So when I was in physical therapy, not only was I bringing the swelling down in the knee and building up the strength of my shaved down meniscus, because that thing was torn up, and then working my new shiny, literally shiny, in the pictures, it's shiny, a shiny ACL. But also, I feel like there's just a piece of hamstring missing in this leg. If I ever reach down and like I bend my leg back to like fix my shoe, I feel it. It is the most bizarre feeling in the world. So there's a lot going on in this leg. 6 weeks of training, of physical therapy, of resting, of taking care of myself. And then I was back on stage for Soy Sox at ALA. Me and Soulmate watched this set back. And if you haven't seen the set, honestly, looking back on it, the dancers in Special Ops Squad at that time were so on point. When you were on Special Ops, you had to be so quick and so clean and so focused in rehearsals. And that's exactly what this squad was. They were so ready to do it. And we put these sets together in no time. Like, their work ethic was amazing. But so we were watching back the set and I was like, oh my gosh, I love this. I actually don't like watching myself back during that whole ALA. What, my hair looked grot, but on stage, I'm in the back majority of the time. Naturally, of course you're gonna put me in the back. She got a gimp leg. But also there was so much atrophy in my leg. Atrophy is what, there's like a deterioration of muscle because I hadn't been on it and I hadn't been as active and working on it. So while my leg was building its strength, it had lost a lot of mass compared to my other leg. So to me, it looks like I have an arm, a skinny little arm sticking out of my hip as a leg. And to me, I'm like, oh God, she is unwell. It doesn't look good. But that set was so much fun. And I remember ALA was, will always be, like, we, CORE loves AX and CORE loves San Diego Comic-Con, of course. But CORE loves ALA, and it's that first ALA was just so much fun. CORE doesn't party. We're all 21 and over. We're far over 21. We are an old crew. There's no youngins on the crew. Because, again, like I said last week, we're juggling our careers as well as CORE. CORE is just something we love. It is literally for the love of the art and the nerd in our heart. So we're all old. We're all in like our mid to late 20s at this time. So when we party like we're super chill. We go out to the bar and we'll have like a drink for fun and then that's it. But like one drink for us, because we're so active, is we're done. So me and Sylvie had our own hotel room at that time. And everyone just, after the performance at Masquerade, I remember we all had like one drink together. Or no, it was Shishi's birthday. We celebrated Shishi's birthday. So of course we went out for dinner and drinks and we went back to the hotel room. And we were just like watching videos and hanging out. And then everyone passed out. I remember staying up with Rostin because like I had my soulmate, you know, tucked away in her bed. And then I know that Jason just falls, he's narcoleptic. He just falls asleep anywhere. So he fell asleep in the little chair in the hotel room. And then Ira fell asleep because Ira and Rostin had to leave for work early the next day. So me and Rostin kind of just stayed up so that he could wake Ira up on time and leave on time. So we ended up staying up and just like watching over everyone and like talking and whatnot. And then at like 6 in the morning, Rostin is such a sweetheart. If you guys didn't love Kiribaku before, you'll love it now. Because when we were prepping everyone for bed, Ross was like, why is Jason like curled up in a chair that he doesn't fit in? So Rossin goes over and just picks him up like a baby. He picks him up and he like spreads him out on the bed next to Iro and like tucks him in and then makes sure he's all he's all comfortable. And Jason's just passed out. He's done for the night. But of course Bakugo had to take care of Kiri. Usually it's the other way around. But so then at 6 a.m., Rossin doesn't even wake up Iro. Iro's like so sleepy and Rossin's like, it's okay, I'm driving anyway. So he just picks up Iro princess style and just walks out. And our loving Levi, he just takes care of his squad always. So then he left for work. So then I finally fell asleep, totally on the floor, just like, bleh, fell asleep. We wake up the next day, and the con was amazing. It was so much fun. We had so much fun at Soy Socks. And this was the last day of the con. I wake up, it is pouring rain outside. Pouring rain at the end of the con. And I'm the first one awake, even though I was the last one asleep. And, sorry, I got a text from my soulmate, and I love her. she cracks me up. It was pouring rain. Like, the rain was sideways. It was so intense. So I wake up Sonali, and Sonali's sleeping. I had tucked her in with her little genie. So she sleeps with genie because her favorite movie at the time, favorite Disney movie at the time was Aladdin. It has changed to Princess and the Frog. But she had her little genie. And so I wake her up. I go, Soulmate, wake up. And she's like, oh. And she wakes up like a baby. And so I'm sitting with her. And then unbeknownst on the other bed, as I'm like waking up Sonali and just like talking to her, I'm like, okay, like I already packed up, but you still need to pack up. While you pack up, I can go get coffee and whatnot. She's like, okay. And then Jason just sits up on the bed like a demon. And we both just look over. And then he looks at us, and Jason already has a deep voice, but in the morning, his voice is deep down and he goes, good morning. And we both went, oh my God. It scared us. I was like, holy cow, this is a demon. But that surprise compared to nothing to on the side. So Soulmate's bed was next to the wall. There's a little sliver of space between the bed and the wall. A hand shoots up and goes on the bed. And we all three of us, Jason, me, and Soulmate, all go, oh, like, there is a human. It's Goge. We had thought he left so long ago. He had passed out in this little crevice the whole night. And he came out and he's just a smile. And he's like, hey, guys. And we were like, what? Have you been there this whole time? He's like, yeah, it was just so comfortable. I fell asleep. It was like a little cave. It was hilarious. I died. And then that, after we got over the fact that a demon got up in the bed and a demon crawled out of hell over here, me, Rostin, and Jason, not Rostin, me, Goge, and Jason hopped in my car while Soulmate helped like clean up the room, and we went out to go get coffee in the rain. I just remember it was really fun. It was like a time I got to bond with Jaswan and Ngoogaloo. And then that was ALA, and from then on, ALA was like always our little vacation. ALA was where we could go and perform and everything, but for us is our little vacation, because AX was always like that. We loved it because AX was, this is when we're gonna work, like we're gonna work so hard at AX. So first time we did Soy Socks on stage, so much fun. If you haven't seen that set, go watch it. Soy Socks, we didn't know at the time, but Soy Socks would end up becoming something greater as the years went on. And I say that because in the next couple months, I want you guys to keep a lookout on the Core's YouTube channel and all of our social media for more information on Soy Socks, because we might have some cool things in the works involving a Soy Socks. But now that Soy Socks is done, we have a bunch of small performances going on in between, leading up into our first collegiate performance of the year, which was Fusion. Now, I say this because, like I said, 2016 was a growing year. It was an evolution year. Now, we're doing so much. We performed Soy Socks again at Hanadoki Con in San Diego. So much fun. We got to actually plug in Amy and Nifa for that performance. Nifa wore a pink pigtail wig, and it was great. And it was great because we also got to do a trip down to San Diego and just like kind of have fun. So now Core has been going out and like traveling and performing, which is super fun for us. For Hanadoki Con, that's where we found our number one sushi place that we've always gone to now that we do every time we go to San Diego for a convention. Core, or at least the Soy Socks, original Soy Soxers, always find the sushi. Soulmate, I thought it was a sushi lounge. We were talking about this the other day. It's not. It's called the Sushi Joint with a Y. The Sushi Joint. And it's always our place. It's in the Gaslamp District. But also, when we went to Hanadoki Con, our lovely Andrew Alandi, if you don't know him, he's an awesome host. He is a great cosplayer. He's a very good friend of all of ours. He introduced us at Hanadoki Con. Hanadoki Con stage Remember how I okay, so now I'm going to use Hanji this time. This is my little Hanji. Isn't she so cute? This is my Hanji to indicate this is a human. This is me. This is me dancing for soy socks. Yay, dancing for soy socks. This is the stage of soy socks. So if this is me dancing for soy socks and say this is like, oh, God bless America, Elsa, girl. This is, who had a blonde wig? No one had. This, let's say this is Amanda because it looks nothing like Amanda. This is how much you could fit two people on that stage. There's like 15 of us. Imagine 15 of us on a stage this big. This stage was so small. But what is Core's motto? You make it work. You adapt. It was funny because we were backstage waiting for the masquerade to be over. And someone was supposed to come get us and prep us. Because when we do masquerades, it's about the contestants of the masquerade. So Core always, we always hang back from a masquerade so that the contestants have the lay of the land, where they have the whole backstage area, because they have to, they're doing a competition, they prep. It's all about them. We're just a performance. We don't have to be there. So we usually stay away until it's time. So someone always has to come get us. So we were like waiting backstage and not, we had so many accessories for soy socks. So a lot of people didn't have, their accessories on them. I remember Chibs just had like her accessories in a pile. And my sister, who's captain at the time, she's like, I'm gonna go like check and see when we're supposed to go on. So she's backstage. She walks all the way around to go into the audience and enters the ballroom from the back. And as she opens the door, she hears Andrew say, "The Core dance crew, we are being announced to go on stage. We are not backstage and we are not ready." So my sister books it out. She runs like a bat out of hell. She was running around. She goes, "We're on stage." So everyone is putting their stuff back on. We are laughing so hard. And then you just see us like pile into the entrance doorway. And we, none of us know what to do. We don't know if like, because then Andrew realizes, oh my gosh, no one got them. So he's stalling because he's awesome. He's stalling for us, but he doesn't quite know if like he should make another introduction or so like he's looking at us and we're just looking at him like and then he awkwardly just start walking onto the stage. And then as we're standing on stage, he goes into a whole spiel again. So now we're just, it is iconic that we just stand on stage for an awkwardly too long amount of time. That's gonna be our lives forever. I remember as we're like facing the back, we always talk to each other on stage. If you ever know Core, we are having full-on conversations on that stage in inopportune times. I remember we were laughing because Amy and Nifa both had like pigtails, and then as they laughed, their shadows would like dance on the wall. So we're now laughing because their shadows are dancing and we're just talking. We're just talking. And then the music starts and we start dancing. We don't fit on this stage at all. So at random times, in order for people to fit on the stage for the choreo, if you were on the side, you just abandoned ship and you just jumped off the stage. You just, if like everyone was on this side, it was like, well, I'm on the farthest edge. I don't really need it on stage. We're not going to fit. So you just jump off. You wait until the formation travels again and you jump back on. When I tell you SO is so well trained, that is good training. When on the fly, you are so in tune with everyone that you know, okay, the three of us, we're not gonna walk in when we usually walk in. We gotta walk in like an eight count later so that we have enough space. Amazing. It is absolutely amazing. So we did Hanadoki and it was just such a fun experience. We also just got to travel to San Diego. We did a bunch of videos down in San Diego, but I was still getting used to camera work and I didn't change the ISO on the videos. So a lot of those videos were just way too bright. I don't know why, I just didn't change the ISO. So we can't use that video footage. My bad. But we have the video footage from ALA, so you should go check that out because we might see our Soy Socks music video come back on there very soon. Plus a new Soy Socks music video that we did at ALA this year, which was a K-pop cover music video, which I'm working on right now. But it's taking a long time because I got ambitious with some effects. And that's my side note for today. So let's go back to what I wrote down. Oh my gosh! And then we did... Okay, I see. I know Sonali and Rio and Liz are in the chat. So they're gonna die. We did our Pokemon set at Anime in Fresno. They're gonna freak out once they hear that. I'm just gonna wait for it for a second. Anime Con in Fresno, Pokemon set. Just because this was such a fun trip. You guys, so many slides. What, Fresno? Okay, this was so much fun. This was about eight of us. Eight of us in a car, and then Nifa and Shishi came with us as our board members to be our managers as we drove. So we literally rented out a van. All of us piled into it. I'm pretty sure, if I can remember everyone, it was me, soulmate, Rio, Liz, Amy, Adam, Brandon, Shishi, and Nifa. Right? I replaced my sister. I remember that. Oh, and Iro was there. So this is the crew that's training for HHI. I was replacing my sister because she couldn't do this performance. So we went as Pokemon people. Pokemon people. We had Ash, Brock, and Misty, and I forget who soulmate was. Serena, I think. And then we had their four starters. We had Iro was Pikachu, Brotp was Charmander, Rio was Bulbasaur, and Amy was, I was gonna say Squidward, Squirtle. Amy was Squirtle. And we actually had a performance at K-Town Night Market up in LA. So we drove up out to LA together, did a performance at K-Town Night Market, and then we were gonna hop into the van again and then drive all the way up 4 hours to Fresno. That K-Town Night Market, you guys, come on, I gotta take a drink because this was a fun trip. It was the most, okay. This series is gonna be so long because the memories are fantastic. So we were at K-Town Night Market. Again, the stage is not, it is not good because it is a whole DJ booth. So there's literally this much depth to the stage. It's long, but it's this shallow. It's fine. We do the performance, but they also gave us swag bags because we were some of the performers. And so they gave us these huge bags with all these different snacks and food items and all this free swag from all the booths that were in the night market. But they also were like, some performers didn't come and pick up their bags. So we were like the last performers to show up because we weren't performed till later in the night, and then it was going to be all like the main singers, and they're like, you know what, we have a whole slew of stuff for the night shift of performers, so like you guys have your swag bags, but if there's like any extra stuff back here, you can take it. Bro GP is right, those bags were so tight. They gave us these little portable Tapatio bottles, and there was a whole box that no one was touching. So I got a lot. I, for the next 4 years, never had to buy Tapatio. And Tapatio was everywhere in my house. Like, that is, at HQ, there was a little Tapatio bottle on my desk. Well, there was like two on my desk hidden. And then there was like three in my bookshelf. So if anyone was eating in the library or in the workroom, you just have to look to the bookshelf, buy one of the books, and there was Tapatio. There was Tapatio hidden up in my bedroom in case I wanted to eat in my bedroom. I had Tapatio in every single bag I owned so that anytime I switched bags or had to take a different bag, it was there. And I also had Tapatio in my car. I had Tapatio everywhere. This is also Rio. You'll remember this. This is also when we discovered those pretzel sticks. They're like Pocky, but they're made by pretzel and they're sticks and they're flavored like Tom Yum soup. And me and Rio were obsessed. We literally were like jonesing for some Tom Yum pretzel sticks, eating them constantly. And so we were like, you know what? We're going to wait until, instead of heading after a performance, we're going to, instead of heading straight to Fresno, we're going to hang out at the market for a little bit. We'll all eat dinner here so that when we drive, it's later in the evening. Shishi and Nifa, who are driving, don't have to drive in the sun. And like, we don't have to stop for food. So we hung out at the night market. Just this core, it was so much fun. We just ate a lot of food. And then we stopped by, I'm gonna say it's the Toyota booth. I think it was the Toyota booth. It was like a car booth. And they had a DJ spinning. And there's music. So what does core do? We start dancing. But when we dance in, like, not on stage, you're not, like, dancing to, like, battle someone. You're dancing like a darn fool. So we start dancing like crazy. We're just, like, bad. Oh, it's Hyundai. Okay. Thank you, Bro TP. Hyundai. Hyundai. My dad had Hyundai. It was Hyundai. Okay. Totally. I'm just a Toyota person. But it was Hyundai, and we danced forever. I still have some of those videos on my phone. I wonder if while I'm talking I can find it, because I definitely have Rio. Rio in a cypher is like a joy that y'all... In a cypher that's not like a core freestyle. Just Rio in a cypher is hilarious, because it's her freestyles are so darn clever. They're just so good. And then she's also crazy. So it's a nice mix. I know I have this video somewhere. Also, Brandon was in there. But we also started to just bring in people to this Hyundai booth. Like, they were like, we don't know who you guys are, but can you... They kept saying, can you stick around? And then they ended up giving us, like, free... They gave us, like, these lanyards, and they gave us little blinky lights, and then they gave us Hyundai water bottles, because they're like, oh my gosh, you're bringing a whole crowd. So we were booth babes for a hot second. Not planning to be. Oh my gosh, I didn't know... Sorry, this is going to blow everyone's minds. This was also when, this year was when OC Millennium OC opened. And I have the video here where we performed a Millennium OC, the opening of that studio. Wow, this year is insane. Oh, this was also the year that Toby did his talent show for his presentation for his PhD. You guys, 2016 was the year. Wow, why, how... How did we do so much in 2016? Oh my gosh, I found the video. Y'all, look, this is Sonali going off. This is what it's turned into. Where's the sound? She's just going off. See, we're just at the Hyundai booth. Going off, living her best life. Hey, that is a... We are just having the time of our lives, living it up. Where's Rio? We need Rio. Rio, oh my gosh, you are insane. Look at her. Look at how cool she is with her hair. Holding Tom Yums. She is holding Tom Yums in her hand. I'm dead. I forgot she danced with Tom Yums in her hand. Oh, that was great. And then it got into early evening, and we all piled back into our car or into our van, and we all drove out to Fresno. We like talked the whole time. Some of us took a nap. Why? There are so many videos of Rio and Lauren sleep so weird in a car. Lauren sleeps with eyes wide open, but Rio does not sleep in comfortable positions. So, like, she's sleeping in a not comfortable position in the car. We're all, like, talking and bonding. Brandon and Amy were bro TPs at the time, and they had a great bonding. Amy will say it's not great, but Brandon will be like, oh my God, we got so close. So we get to the hotel room out in Fresno late at night. And two things happen. We have two rooms connected to each other. So, you know, four are in one room, and the rest of us are in the other room. Oh, I didn't realize. I don't usually take the bed. I remember I put the two couches together and I made a nice little nest. I like making nests. But also, I gotta have my dancers get their beauty sleep. So I made a little nest for myself because I like to sleep. I have not explained raisins yet. We're getting to raisins. But we're in Fresno, and two things happened. One, it's like 3 a.m. and we needed to get some toiletries. So me and Brandon go out, because there's a CVS across the street, but it is like in the dead of night. So me and Brandon go out to the CVS. Now, I will say, if you walk anywhere with me, you kind of don't have to worry. I'm not a welcoming person. I'm not a welcoming person when you first meet me. So I always tell people, like, walk with me, because I don't look friendly if I don't need to look friendly. Like, I'll be like, I am protecting my own. Yeah, precious. So me and Brandon go out, but also Brandon's really good to walk with too, because he always knows, like, He always knows where he is. We've never been there, and he knows where he is. So we're talking and walking. We go up to CVS. We walk past a dumpster. From behind the dumpster, a man just, like, pops out. He doesn't look at me at all. He completely ignores me. He hones in right on Brandon. And he just looks to Brandon, and he goes, "You want to buy some tomatoes?" And Brandon just kind of laughs. Because, like, the guy's, like, way too close to him. And Brandon's like, "No, thank you." He's so polite. And the guy just goes, "Ugh." And, like, disappears behind the dumpster. And we start, me and Brandon look at each other. We burst out laughing. And then Brandon's like, "That was so random." He's notorious for random interactions like that. Like, he's like, "People think I'm kidding." And I was like, no, I was here. I witnessed this. That was totally random. But while Brandon's, like, freaking him out about the randomness, I was more like, where are the tomatoes? He wasn't holding anything. So now I am now existentially confused where these proverbial tomatoes are. So my night is ruined. But we go into CVS, we grab a bunch of snacks and, like, toiletries that we need, and we come back to the room, and of course we tell everyone about the tomato man. Was it tomatoes? It was tomatoes. It was tomatoes. Then Rio and Adam need to get something from the car. Just from the car. It's just in the parking lot. That's all. It's not that far. So they leave, and we're like, "Okay, we'll leave. We'll leave the door open for you." They're gone for slightly too long. Like, it probably should have taken all of 10 minutes if they just walked slowly out to the car, rummaged in the car for a little bit, then came back. When they do finally come back, about, like, 15, 20 minutes later, they come running in, laughing, and they just fall on the floor laughing so hard. And, of course, all of us are excited. We're like, "What are you laughing about?" They're like, "We went into the wrong room." I'm like, "What do you mean you went into the wrong room?" They're like, "Another guy." Rio's not making any... When Rio laughs, she's done. So she is laughing. She's now done. Adam is trying to explain what's going on. Adam's like, "There was another door that was open, and we forgot what our room is, so we thought, oh, it's the open door." And we opened the door, and there was... See, Rio remembers. And there was just... It was not our room. There was just a man sleeping. And they're like, "Oh my God, this is the wrong room." So they just left and then found our room. And while they're laughing, all of us were like, "Did you close his door? Like, did you just leave this poor man's open door?" And they were like, they stopped laughing. They're like, "Oh, I think so." They went so far in. So we haven't even gotten to the con yet, guys. This is just the night before. So much is happening. We finally wake up the next day. We get ready for the con. We go to the con. It's in a fairgrounds, but it's a small con, and the fairgrounds are huge. So it's very easy to get lost. But we had fun at Anime. The stage, again, was cement, and we hadn't planned for that. Also, I'm still recovering from knee, so I was like, I'm not going to do any of the floor work. And I remember we had this part where we had Pokeballs in our hands, and we were doing whacking with Pokeballs, and there were pins in the Pokeballs to keep. We had these elastic things on the Pokeballs that we slipped on our finger so that even if you accidentally let go or, like, you hit your hand against something, Pokeball, Styrofoam Pokeball wouldn't go flying out of your hand. In that video, we're whacking, and then at the end of it, you kind of see Amy. She walks off stage because she's not in the next piece. She kind of looks at her hand like this and, like, shrugs, and then just moves on. A pin is bamboo slid underneath her nail, and she was just like, "Oh, gosh." She just keeps dancing, and it's not until after the dance she, like, pulls it out. I was like, "Amy." And she was like, I mean, she did, like, she gave it all of 2 seconds to be like, "Oh, darn," and then went on. You see it in the video. Absolutely hilarious. So that was our anime, and it was, like, we were testing out the combination that we would take to HHI at anime. So it was nice to have, like, a performance where we, like, did it on stage. We could re-watch it back and, like, kind of build off of it. So we come back from that. We do WonderCon for the first time this year, you guys. WonderCon. This is our first year doing it. I had just reached out. If you don't know the story of our journey into San Diego Comic-Con, I put it on my story before. I never could get into San Diego Comic-Con. For years, I would go online and try to get a badge, and I would always get into that white waiting room of death. It's just like a white window, and I would never make it, and then the badges would be sold out. And for years, I would try to get in, and I couldn't. So I finally, one year, I think it was like 2012, I decided, if I can't get to San Diego Comic-Con with a guest badge, I'm going to go as a performer. Or as not an attendee, as someone who's behind the panel table. This was the year that I was going to make that dream come true. And it started with touching base with Martin. Martin is the organizer for a lot of the entertainment for San Diego Comic-Con, which they also run WonderCon. And we had reached out to him the year before, and he's like, oh my gosh, I love what you guys do, but our San Diego this year is already full, so let's touch base again next year. So he was like, would you perform for WonderCon? I was like connecting with him, and he said, well, WonderCon this year, we're not in Anaheim, because usually it's in the Anaheim Convention Center. He's like, this year we're at LA Convention Center, and we have access to the Microsoft Theater at LA Live. The Microsoft Theater at LA Live. This is a theater where they hold like the Emmys or the Tony Awards. Or the Oscars. Like, if you go backstage, it is just it is so bougie in LA and high end. And they have so many great performances there. And a year before, at Beyond the Northern Wall, when we were at AX, and I was going to Urban Tom's with a bunch of different corpsmen to go eat, me and Jenna, who was my captain that year, me and Jenna stopped in front of the Microsoft Center, the Microsoft Theater. And I looked up at the marquee. And I looked at Jenna and I said, we're going to perform there. And she was like, okay. And I was like, yeah. My goal is I want to get Core to perform in there. She was like, oh, I believe you. And here we were, WonderCon 2016, performing our Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and X-Men set on the Microsoft Theater stage. That was a trip. Our minds were blown. It was so much fun. I actually took to the stage on that one. Wow, I really did not rest my knee at all. My sister had to stay. She usually was Psylocke. She was Psylocke the last time we did our X-Men cosplay at LA at Kamikaze, but she had to stay as Skye for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So I donned the Psylocke cosplay, and I actually finally got to be Melinda May for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. because that was my original role before I busted the knee. So. Not only was it iconic that we got to perform at the Microsoft Theater, but I also finally got to do the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. set because I had it. I didn't get to do it as full as I wanted to because the knee was still recovering, but I got to do it. It was so much fun. At that performance, you will see the notorious moment when Lauren loses her Mystique red wig. That red wig just dropped off her head on stage. And so she picks it up during whacking, and you bet your bottom dollar she started whacking with a whole red wig in her hand. She didn't miss a beat. She just also had no hair on her head. And so begins the journey of Lauren losing her wig over the years. But it was great. What was also crazy was that Toby and Cokie, in the first half, we were Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So Toby was Ward and Cokie was Fitz. And then when we changed into X-Men, when the X-Men infiltrated, the reason why we needed that whole Deadpool section was because we needed to give people time to change. But specifically, we needed to give Toby and Cokie time to change because at the Microsoft Theater, the stage is up here and you go backstage and it's like a long, like the backstage is huge. You gotta go all the way out and then like down a couple levels, and then the dressing rooms, it is just so large and lush and beautiful down there, but our dressing room was so far away from the actual stage. They had to run all that way, go into our dressing room, and blew their face because Toby was Beast and Cokie was Nightcrawler. They did a full, like, props to our Minas, both Justine and Little, who played Mina for Boku no Hero. But like the original full out makeup and it not getting everywhere was Toby and Cokie, because they did it on sweaty bodies. Like, not skin prepped at all. Sweaty bodies. They just blued everything. While Goge is Deadpooling up a storm above them. And then they make it on stage for X-Men. It was insane. Also, fun fact, for that Deadpool section, before the Deadpool song plays, the Deadpool theme song, that ukulele Deadpool rap is actually Goge rapping. He came to the house prior, and I said, and it's freestyle. That entire rap was freestyle. So, honestly, go back and watch it. It is, Goge freestyling is amazing, because he's not only just clever, he's funny, and he's talented. So he's just playing the ukulele and rapping, and we were like, whatever, I said, it's one take, so whatever you say, we're gonna use. And it was great, it was hilarious. And that performance sat with us for a really long time. We did celebrate. We ate again at Urban Tom's. We always go to Urban Tom's after a performance at LA Convention Center. And we ate all together, and we kind of reveled in this accomplishment that we got to perform on a stage that most A-list and let alone B-list celebrities haven't gotten to be on yet. And so we got to be on it. And that was something that, like, we loved. And you know, they loved the performance. It wasn't a full house by any means, because that theater is way too large. But we didn't care. Who cares if it's a full house? You perform for the people that are there. And the people that are there, we performed our hearts out for them. And it was so much fun. So now, this is all Special Ops. Special Ops just did 4 different sets in 3 months. That's a lot of sets. That's a lot of rehearsal. But at the same time, we're still doing Omega set. So Omega set, if we weren't swamped before, we were more swamped now, because we're like, oh, at UB, we're going to do one set. And then at Fusion, which is less than a month away, we're going to do a completely different other set. And so at UB, we did denim set. Well, we call it denim set. It was actually a one song set. It was to Justin Bieber's What Do You Mean, but it's 2 covers of that. One by Kina Granis and then one by Carmen. And it was actually based off of choreo, the last choreo that I did before I went into surgery. So this was like the last piece of choreography that I made originally with the old knee prior to new knee. And this set was actually very difficult. It was a choreography set and it had a lot of technique in it. And it was probably one of the rare times where I felt that me and the team were not on the same page. I had been working with SO, and SO worked a certain way. They worked faster. They worked not better, but we worked faster. And for Corpsmen, I mean, they can sound off in the chat. You know, when you work with me, like, I don't like repeating myself. 2, I have a very high standard of work, and I'm also choreographing and creating with my soulmate, and we both work the same quickly and efficiently, and you make it work. I also came from a studio background, and my career is also dancing. So I have a certain level of professionalism that I was able to bring out in SO. And I forgot that we hadn't really eased Omega Crew into that, because they weren't performing as often as SO was performing. So Omega Crew was kind of used to when we were still just like a project, and we were still kind of just friends, kind of just having fun. So I'm taking in this really intense way of performing and rehearsing into denim set. I remember there was a day where, and like, I will say there was 50-50 blame for myself, but also for the team at the time. We had blocked a chorus the week before, and so we were moving on with the rest of the set. But when that chorus part, because everyone was in different sections, when those dancers were up for the chorus, they came onto the floor and they stopped dancing. And I remember I stopped the music and I was like, okay, what's going on? And they're like, we don't remember it. And I'm like, okay, well, but we don't have time to reteach something we just spent all last week on. Like, we're running out of time. And I do get frustrated and I do yell. I'm a yeller. But here's the thing. Since high school, I've always done this thing in my brain where I know I get frustrated very, very easily. I'm very easily frustrated. So I have to consciously make the decision not to blow off the handle the first time around. So if something frustrates me, I don't say anything the first time, because maybe it's a fluke. Maybe it was just something a one-off. The second time, I go, okay, all right. This is now twice we've done it. So, like, we gotta look at things. By the third time, I say something and I go, okay. Like, I'm already frustrated for a third time, but I go, okay. Now we need to know that we keep doing this thing, and this thing is frustrating me in terms of core. This is now the third time we've had to backtrack in rehearsal and we're behind schedule. And then I always add a buffer of 4 or 5 times. So let me just break that down for you guys. I give anyone in my life 5 chances to not do what they're supposed to do before I get upset. That's a lot. That is a lot. So you could literally punch me 5 times and I won't say something until the 6th time. I won't get frustrated until the 6th time. I will say something at the 3rd time, hoping that you'll fix it. I give you 2 more chances after that, and then she blows. And when she blows, she blows, because Todoroki is that icy hot steam heat. So I was very upset. We are now behind schedule. My dancers still don't know the choreo. It's the same choreo we've been working on. So it was not a good time. I was really running Omega crew into the ground. But also, I wasn't dancing for the collegiate performances because I was like, I've been dancing a lot for the SO ones, so I got to rest my knee. So now Soulmate has to take the duty of being a director and a performer. But now I'm back into being just a director watching. And I was being a little bit harder. What was great was that the SO crew was like, no, this is just how we work. We have to push through. And Omega crew, because they didn't get that experience, it was kind of a shock for them. So that whole fusion, denim set at fusion, it was not a good relationship between me and the crew. It just was not. I will take blame for that. I will also say they take blame for that. There was a lot going on. We did remedy it. There was a good solution and a good way and going back to dancing together when we got to villain set for UB. And I will say that because, one, Disney Villains. We had been excited for it all year. 2, Disney Villains was supposed to be our first step into creating the Into the Kingdom sequel to Beyond the Northern Wall. And 3, we kind of made it together organically and we had a much shorter amount of time between UB and Fusion. It was like maybe 5 weeks. But remember, we rehearse once a week. So we had 5 rehearsals to put together. So everyone was like, okay, because we know this and we know how like denim set didn't work out very well. We were also frustrated. Everyone was like, all right, let's just focus and get through this together. And we did have a good time. Now, I'm going to end this stream with explaining to you guys where raisins came from. So, the song for Maleficent, and my sister played Maleficent for Villain Set and for Into the Kingdom because she just looks like Angelina Jolie. She is Maleficent. She's beautiful and gorgeous and all powerful. And then Bro TP, Liz, played Yzma, fantastic Yzma. Lauren played Cruella, fabulous Cruella. Brandon played Scar because of course Brandon has to play Scar. And Goge played Dr. Facilier. Which, by the way, Dr. Facilier is my favorite villain. I wish he was in Princess and the Frog so much more. He's my favorite. I think he's the most clever villain. He's a Capricorn villain because he has connections with people, more powerful people, and he's manipulative. So he is a Capricorn villain. Now, the song from Maleficent was a song from Viora called Silk. And when we were putting together that closer number, where she comes in with all her little heartless, and they do this clump breakdown at the end. And we built that breakdown together as a unit. We did it the same way we did Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., where we all kind of like were together in the room, we dedicated one rehearsal, and everyone kind of like gave moves or gave input, or we like tried and experimented. So it was a great way for us to reconnect as a company with me as a director who was like, and I will say there was that separation because I wasn't dancing with Omega as much and I was recovering from my knee. It was able to like bring us back together. In that whole breakdown, it's going heart, heart, breaker, breaker. Like there's so many words. There's a part where it sounded like, and me and Soulmate are notorious for butchering lyrics, where all of a sudden it just goes, butta, and there's one lyric, and it sounded like she just goes, raisins, and we kept laughing, and that's the part where this whole group of people just dab. It's like when dabbing first started to surface from the eighth circle of hell, and so dabbing was brand new, and so we were like, you know what, Adam keeps doing it, let's do it. So they dabbed on raisins, and we just laughed because we're like, I think they say reasons, but we all just said raisins. And then I remember my sister made the joke, because later on Maleficent would be in Into the Kingdom, and with, like, you know, the 104th with Aaron Yeager and Sora, and she's like, oh my gosh, because of raisins, to show how evil Maleficent is, we should do a promo video where Maleficent reaches out to, like, Aaron Yeager and Sora and is like, I want to do a peace offering. And she offers this plate of what looks like chocolate chip cookies. And then all of the squad gets the chocolate chip cookies and they bite into it. And then a look of horror comes into their face and they look at Maleficent, and then Maleficent looks at the camera and goes, raisins. And I'm supposed to show how evil she was. So, like, raisins just became why we say reason. So anytime anything happens, we say, because raisins. Because it was supposed to be reasons. And that has kept, it's not that great of a story, you guys. It's not groundbreaking. But that's why, to this day, so many of us always go, anytime we make a decision, we go, and you know what? Because raisins. And once someone on core says raisins, everyone just kind of goes, well, I mean, yeah, raisins. So it's like our universal, it's not even like, it's our universal surrender, because it's not like we're really complying, or it's not like we support raisins. It's kind of like, oh, well, okay, raisins. And that's where it came from. And so at Fusion, we performed Villain Set. And actually at that Fusion with Villain Set, it was cathartic, and it was a moment, because after that set, before we hit the summer, a couple of our dancers actually were like, you know what, we've been here since the beginning, and it's starting, we see that it's evolving into a business, a company, and there are some like-minded people like that, most of SO, super like-minded, like, we are ready to take this to the next level. And other people were like, you know what, this is just not my cup of tea. So their last performance was actually Fusion Villains, Disney Villains Set. And after that, we said goodbye. I will be honest and say, at the time, not on great terms, but to, like, now, all those alumni that left between Villains Set and Into the Kingdom, we still talk to them. They're still our friends, because just because someone leaves something, it doesn't mean it's the end-all, be-all. Just because someone leaves core, it doesn't mean all the friendship and all these good memories that I've been sharing suddenly disappear. They're still there. They're just not dancing with core. But that's just kind of how I live my life in general. One aspect of a relationship is not the whole relationship. You have to look at everything universally. And so after Villain Set, at Fusion, for raisins, some of our Coors men who had been with us since the very beginning, that maxed out 2013, ended up saying their last sotomayto, and they left. And then, summer, for preview night, they showed up to watch our Into the Kingdom preview night, and it was awesome. So it just goes to show that evolution and change is essential to creating something that's going to last through time, and that's okay. And maybe it's not okay in the moment, but time heals all wounds. That's a lie. Time doesn't heal all wounds. It's time and mother truckin' effort. Just like my knee. I can't just, like, sit down for 6 weeks and think after 6 weeks, it's gonna be fine to get up. No, it's time. It's those 6 weeks. And then you put the effort in to work really hard and build it back up. And that's what it was. When our alumni ended up leaving and becoming alumni, we were like, all right, we're not on the great enough terms, but you know what? Let's rebuild this connection so that we keep core at its foundation, which is a place where those can give their hearts for everyone, for the love of the art and the nerd in our heart. And I really think of that transformative time of going into the kingdom, into the summer, as something super... I had the word. It's going to come to me. But it was the ultimate Pokemon evolution. I mean, we'd hit a new level of evolution later on. But this was like us making... It was a big decision. It's like if Pikachu, like Ash's Pikachu, had suddenly been like, oh my God, after all these years, I'm a Raichu on this B. And you're like, oh my gosh, but you've been Pikachu for so long. But it's not wrong. And so that was the end of... And I think that was the last time we performed in the collegiate scene. No, I'm such a liar. I keep thinking every year is the last time we perform in the collegiate scene. It's not. We would return one more time. But we did end Villain Set. We had so much fun with it. It was great. And then that ended the spring. And then we got to go headfirst into the summer, which would be the sequel to Beyond the Northern Wall, which was Into the Kingdom. And that's where we're going to start next week. Guys, 2016 is such a big year. It needs to be split into 3 episodes. Like, that, so much has happened. But that's where we're going to end today. Villain Set, into the Kingdom. So I hope you enjoyed the journey thus far, exploring everything beyond this northern wall and everything that we have. Thank you for traveling down memory lane with me, because I was not planning to show those videos from K-Town Night Market, but they are just so wonderful, and I'm probably going to go delve into the black hole that is core history videos. And if you would like to join me on that, I mean, not with me, but join in that journey, you can head to our YouTube channel and watch all of our videos from way back when. Now you get a little bit more insight into ALA, into the Pokemon set, into Soy Sox, into Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. You get a little look at all of that. But we'll go into the Kingdom next week, starting next week. Same time, same place here up beyond the Northern Wall. I know that I put a thing of it up, and I need to get the date of it because I don't have it. But Lumica Night will be this Sunday, August 16th. Lumica, who is a sponsor of Core and a collaborator, will be holding their Oban Night. I hope I said that right. Oban Night World Livestream. It is on Twitch. It is Sunday from 12. Oh, this is Japan time. Oh, holy cow. It's Japan time. So noon in Japan to 8 p.m. I don't know what that is for us. I just can't think of that off the top of my head. But it is on Sunday, and they are doing a live stream. They have a bunch of performers. They have a bunch of special DJs. Get your lights going. Dress up in cosplay for it just to have a party in your own house. And it'll be super awesome. So remember, this Sunday... I mean, do the math, the world line. I don't know. I hit my thing. And make sure that you pre-order our hats, because the pre-orders for our hats are going to end this month. So make sure you get your hat. It is so awesome. Ba-bam. Because once those pre-orders close, they close. And then this hat goes away for a while. So these are exclusives. We won't get these all year long. So they're only available until August 27th, I think. And if you missed Trini's class last night, it was so good. You guys, like, I mean, I love all the classes that we have, but Trini's class was so good. Me and Rawson were like really analyzing it. We're like, okay, we need to put more style in this. It's like, you need to move faster. You know, you can't, like, living our best lives. It was such a good class. She'll be teaching again this Saturday at 11 a.m. our time. Pacific Standard Time. If you follow us, if you don't follow us on social media, please do. We are on Instagram as The Core Dance Crew. We also have our Twitter, The Core Dance Crew, and our Facebook page, The Core Dance Crew. But also here on YouTube, we'll be posting that Zoom class. It is completely free. It is free. You can pop in. You can turn on your video. You can turn off your video. If you're too shy, just come in and sit in, and you can just watch Trini kind of be awesome. And then she will hold a Q&A at the end where she can talk about. She had some great questions last night, and she's just so much fun to watch. So this Saturday, and then Sunday is Lumica night, so there's a lot going on. Woo-woo! And then Sunday evening you can also watch Koki eat another vegetable. I don't know what vegetable he's gonna eat, but it's just kind of fun because he hates vegetables, and it is like a mom joy in my heart to watch him eat the vegetables because he's being healthy, but also like, you don't like it and you're making a funny face and it makes me happy that you're still eating it even though you don't like it. So watch Koki at 6:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Eat another vegetable and we'll see if he likes it. I'm hoping there's one vegetable he likes. I don't know. But with that being said, we're going to call it out. Sotomayor on three. 1, 2, 3. See you next week. Sotomayor.